Hello everyone. So today we are going to discuss the poetic devices used in the poem A Thing of Beauty written by John Keats. This poem is divided into four stanzas and we will discuss all these poetic devices stanza wise. Let's have a look on stanza 1. A thing of beauty is a joy forever. Its loveliness increases, it will never pass into nothingness, but will keep a bower quiet for us and a sleep full of dreams and health and quiet breathing. So this is our stanza 1. Let's discuss which poetic devices have been used here. In stanza 1, there are three poetic devices have been used. The first one is rhyming scheme, the next one is alliteration, and the third one is metaphor. Let's discuss these poetic devices one by one and locate them in the stanza 1. Now if we talk about rhyming scheme plays a very important role in this poem. And why does it play a important role? Because this poem, A Thing of Beauty, is oftenly confused with another poem that we have already discussed, is Keeping Quiet. Because both these poems deal with nature. And the students that get confused while writing their answers in the final examination. So keep one thing in your mind, that this poem, A Thing of Beauty, is written in rhyming scheme, and the previous one, that is Keeping Quiet, it is written in blank verse. Blank verse means there is no rhyming scheme. So where is it used and how do we locate rhyming schemes? Let's discuss it first. So here at the end you can see forever, never, keep, sleep, and so on. Now the last sound is matching, synchronizing with the sound of the next sentence at the end. So never, ever, never, keep, sleep. So this is what we call a rhyming scheme. And the rhyming scheme that has been used here is AABBC. If I locate it A, then same sound will be here, and this will be B and B. And similarly, there is no synchronization here, so we will keep it as C. So this is what rhyming scheme is all about in stanza 1. Now the next poetic device that has been used here is alliteration. Now alliteration is a kind of thing which is always used in bulk by the poets. So you can find it anywhere. So in this stanza 1, it has been used efficiently by the poet. And where is it used? Let's locate it. It is sleep and sweet. Now what is alliteration? Use of consonant sound at the start of two words which are close in series. So we can see sleep and sweet, they both are in close series. So sa sound is being repeated, and that's why it is alliteration. Now one more poetic device that has been used here is metaphor. Now we all are aware that what does a metaphor mean? Metaphor means what? Metaphor means an indirect comparison of something with something. But when we make a direct comparison, that is called as a simile. But here we will focus on metaphor. Metaphor has been used here, and it is used in bower quiet. Now bower means what? Bower means a shady place, and quiet means calmness. It means the calmness of the bower is compared to the calming effect of the beautiful things. So these are the poetic devices that has been used in stanza 1. Let's discuss stanza 2 and the poetic devices used in. Therefore, on every morrow, are we wreathing a flowery band to bind us to the earth? Spite of dispotence, of the inhuman dearth, of noble natures, of the gloomy days, of all unhealthy and over-darkened ways, made for our searching, yes, in spite of all, some shape of beauty moves away the pall from our dark spirits. So this is our stanza 2. Let's discuss the poetic devices. Again, three poetic devices have been used here. The first one is anaphora, the next one is alliteration, and the next one is metaphor. So we will locate these poetic devices in stanza 2. So let's discuss these poetic devices. The first poetic device is anaphora. Now what does anaphora mean? Use of same word in two consecutive lines. That is called as anaphora. Let's locate it in the stanza 2. Of course, we can see OF is being here, used here, and again OF is used here. So it means what? that two consecutive lines are there, and because now we can call it a line because a punctuation mark comma has been used here. So of the inhuman dearth, of the novel nature. So of is being repeated in the two consecutive lines, so it will be placed in the category of anaphora. So this is also a poetic device. Now let's look at the other poetic devices that have been used here is alliteration. So as I said earlier, that alliteration is always used in bulk by the poets to make or to create the essence, the rhyme we can call. So again, I will not discuss the meaning, what actually does it mean, as it has been already discussed. So let's look at where alliteration has been used. So first of all, alliteration is used in band to bind. It means what? That they are closely in series. Band, bur sound, and it is again binding with other one word, that is bind. So bur sound is being repeated again, so it is alliteration. And one more alliteration is used here, some shape. Again, sir sound is here, and again sir in some and sir in shape. So both are alliterations. Now one more poetic device has been used here, and the poetic device is metaphor. Metaphor, as already discussed, in direct comparison with something, so that is metaphor. So metaphor has been used here, wreathing a flowery band to bind us. Wreathing a flowery band to bind us. Now what does it mean? It means what? It is a kind of poetic device where wreathing means what? Bind. And if we talk about the meaning of this particular indirect comparison of this particular phrase, it would be the beautiful things of our life bind us to the earth. So these are the poetic devices which have been used in stanza 2. Let's come on to the other poetic devices that has been used in other theme places. Now let's come on to stanza 3. Now what does stanza 3 say? Such the sun, the moon, trees old and young, sprouting a shady boon for simple sheep, and such are daffodils, with green world they live and clear rills, that for themselves a cooling covert make, gainst the hot season the mid forest break. So this is our stanza 3, and some poetic devices have also been used here, and again we will go with those poetic devices. The first one is alliteration, next one is imagery, and next one is antithesis. So before going to stanza 3, let's make a difference, because there is always a confusion between oxymoron and antithesis. The people, they get confused, the students especially. An oxymoron is a phrase that uses two contradictory or opposing terms, while an antithesis is a device that presents two contrasting ideas in a sentence but not in the same phrase. So if we talk about antithesis, then it means they are obviously separated by commas or semicolons, and in oxymoron it would be a full sentence and they are followed by each other. So I hope you all have understood the difference between oxymoron and antithesis. So let's come on to the poetic devices used in stanza 3. So the poetic devices, as I discussed, alliteration, imagery, and antithesis. So first of all, alliteration, where it has been used. But if you want to talk about alliteration, let's locate it in stanza 3. Sprouting a shady, then we have one more, simple sheep, and one more is the cooling covert. So in the first one, sir sound is being repeated. Again, in the second one, simple sheep, it means what? Again, sir sound is there. And cooling covert, again, it is the k sound which is being repeated. So the next poetic device that we have with us is all about imagery. Now, what is imagery? Imagery can be differentiated into different categories. Imagery, but just have a simple logic, that images means what? That when we close our eyes and when we can create that illusion, that when we can create that image in our mind, that would be considered as a imagery. So trees giving shade, shady boon is used here. So growing process of daffodils, okay, so daffodils with green world they live in, so a process is being there. Clean river streams, the clear rills means narrow streams, the water canals that we call, they have been used here. So imagery is there. So just close your eyes, just think about these things, they will be in front of your eyes and you can live that moment within that particular time. Now let's come on to the last one, last poetic device used in stanza 3. It is antithesis. Antithesis, as I discussed, opposite words placed together, okay, but they will be in different phrases, they will be in different sentence, okay. So here, if you have to locate it, old and young, but so you can see a comma has been used, so it is differentiating it from the others. So this is what antithesis is all about. So now let's discuss the other poetic devices used in stanza 4. Now what does stanza 4 say? Rich with the sprinkling of fair musk rose blooms, and such too is the grandeur of the dooms we have imagined for the mighty dead, all lovely tales that we have heard or read, an endless fountain of immortal drink pouring on to us from heaven's brink. So what a lovely stanza, what a lovely but very beautifully explained by the poet. Let's discuss which poetic devices have been used here. So again, there is a bulk of alliteration, metaphor, rhyme and imagery. An oxymoron is also used here. So we will discuss them one by one where actually they have been used here. So first of all, we will discuss about alliteration. So let's locate the poetic devices. The first one is alliteration. Let's discuss it with the help of stanza 4. So where is it used here? Actually, it is used in the third line, or that is have heard. So if I have to locate it, sorry, it is the fourth line, have heard. Have heard means what? Her sound is being repeated. So it is what? It is again alliteration. So in this way you can find, I have located it for you people. You can locate it by yourself also, wherever you find such kind of repetition in the sounds. So next, let's go to the other one. The other one is metaphor. And metaphor means what? Immortal drink. Immortal drink. Now immortal drink means what? Which make immortal or which doesn't allow you to die. Immortal, eternal you can call. So beautiful objects of nature are forever, like a never-ending portion of a drink. So indirect comparison has been made. Between what? Between the beautiful objects of the nature and never-ending portion of a drink. So this is all about immortal drink. And one more poetic device that has been used very efficiently by the poet is all about rhyming scheme. So rose, dooms, dead, red, drink, brink. Again, a rhyming scheme is used here. So it can also be categorized, or it can also be placed in the category of poetic devices. Now, one more poetic device that has been used here is oxymoron. Now, oxymoron means what? Two contrasting ideas. Okay, in a sentence. So where has it been used? If I have to locate it, I would locate it very nicely, precisely, and it is immortal drink. Sorry, it's not immortal drink, it is mighty dead. Mighty and dead. They are very mighty, but they are also dead. So two contrasting ideas, because oxymoron, if I bifurcate this word, oxy and moron. Oxy means sharp, moron means stupid. Sharp, stupid. So two contrasting ideas have been used here. So, and at last, if I have to locate the poetic devices that are left, it is imagery. And imagery means what? Bushes full of musk roses. So here in the first line, the bushes full of musk roses, it means what? Sprinkling of fair musk rose blooms. Books describing valor of fighters, grandeur, okay, mighty dead, okay, so we can correlate it with this, that pouring from the heaven's brink, so it can be pouring from heaven's brink, so it can be God giving, God providing us with the best things around us. So these are the poetic devices that has been used. So I have skipped a poetic device in stanza 2, and it was imagery. Okay, imagery means, as I have discussed earlier, that it is all about imagination and an illusion that you make by closing your eyes. So a flowery band to bind us. So you can just have a look about a particular place which you have visited, where lots and lots of flowers were there. So you will correlate yourself with that particular thing. So inversion is also there. Normal order of words is reverse. Are we reading a flowery band? So this is inversion. Inversion means opposite. Ulta kar dena, that is means inversion. So this is all about the poetic devices. I hope all of you have understood the poetic devices. If you have really understood, if you really like the video, like, share and subscribe this channel. Okay, thanks for watching.